A bug's world is no place to let down your guard. At every step, there are stealthy assassins.
Big mandibles, good vision, and they talk.
Merciless superheroes and prize fighters poised to take you down.
And we thought only vampires drank blood.
In the treacherous world of monster bugs, you stay vigilant or vanish. In some monster bug battles, individuals take the honors. In others, the spoils of war are shared. But when superheroes go head to head, it's only their superpowers that matter. When a green-bellied huntsman tackles a colony of jumping jack ants, it's a clash of the titans. If an army is only as strong as its weakest soldier, then a squad of jumping jack ants is a force to be reckoned with. Small in size, big on attitude, they're tough and powerful from head to tail.
Even though these are small ants, they are really fierce ants. They've got a strong, potent sting that really packs a punch.
Barely one third of an inch long, jumping jack ants fight well above their weight and deliver a mean punch from both ends. At the front, large serrated mandibles that bite, grip, and slash.
These mandibles can pack a nasty bite, but this is nothing compared to the sting that they have at the back end that is capable of injecting a truly nasty venom that can incapacitate or kill prey very quickly.
With a stinger on the end of its extraordinarily agile tail, the jumping jack can deliver toxic proteins in repeated stings. Powerful enough to induce fatal allergic reactions in humans, the venom is usually reserved for smaller prey, like cockroaches, march flies, and grasshoppers.
You would think that these ants are going out and capturing prey for themselves. That isn't so. Actually, these jumping jack ants live on nectar, a little bit of sugar water. Primarily, they're bringing back the prey to feed the developing ant larvae that need meat in order to grow.
The larvae are hidden away in nests built with soil. Nests are often constructed under rocks or tree roots. Away from the nest, a jumping jack ant forages alone. Its never-ending job is to bring home the bacon, no matter how cumbersome. It's a pit bull and pack horse rolled into one.
These jumping jack ants are really strong ants. They can be grabbing prey, holding onto them with their mandibles, and at the same time, even as the prey is fighting them, they can keep moving them gradually toward their colony.
The jumping jack ant has one more astonishing skill. Like a super action hero, it leaps tall branches in a single bound. But it's not the only bug in this forest with superhero status. The green-bellied huntsman is an arch-villain, not afraid to show its true colors.
If you look at this spider's belly or the joints of its legs, you'll see that it's a beautiful blue-green color. That's because they have a very different form of blood than humans, and they use this blood to pump up their legs, and if the blood pressure drops, the legs will go limp, just like a hose would when you turn the faucet off.
With their hydraulically assisted takeoff, green bellies are super fast, all-terrain hunters with the will to kill. This huntsman also keeps a low profile. Camouflaged one minute, prowling the next. A stealthy loner in search of other speedy spiders. This unsuspecting wolf spider is taken down before it knew what hit it. The green belly's vicious fangs rip into its body, mashing it up.
The green-bellied huntsman's fangs are large and powerful. So once they've been driven into a prey, there are no second chances.
For an accomplished hunter, a large, solitary foe is an easy target. But what happens when the green flash encounters a warring gang of jumping jack ants?
It's facing a bunch of pesky little ants. There's not much to bite onto. And even if it kills one or several, there's more coming.
Next, showdown. Super ants versus an arch villain. Then, two tough guys slug it out in the rainforest. And later, pro fighters in a no-holds-barred battle. On the forest floor, a low-slung superhero is about to face a team of brutal base jumpers.
Big mandibles, good vision, and they jump. And they're able to jump relatively long distances. The thing is even though these are small ants, they are really fierce ants.
This is jumping jack territory, an underground nest and a patch of forest where they forage for food to feed their larvae. The green-bellied huntsman is hungry too, and it's waiting for a kill. But it's been spotted by a lone jumping jack ant. It launches at the interloper. The green flash grabs it and sinks in its fangs. But the jumping jack gets in a well-timed sting. Toxic proteins, four times more potent than bee venom, target cells and critical organs, partially paralyzing the huntsman. Worse still, the alarm has been sounded back at the colony. More ants rush in. The spider manages to crush one in its jaws, but has been stung again.
Jumping jack ants are really quite aggressive, and they're not going to back off just because a single ant has been killed. This is ant behavior. Once they start attacking, they keep going.
The ants work as a team, creating a diversion up front. While one stings the disabled spider from the rear. Even more powerful venom floods into the green belly's body. As toxins begin destroying the spider's internal organs, the once pumped up and powerful legs dangle uselessly. Still, the jumping jacks attack. Mandibles slash the spider. A blister of green blood swells from a gash in the abdomen. Still attacking with their razor-sharp mandibles, the jumping jack ants lap up the green belly's lifeblood.
And we thought only vampires drank blood. The ants are lapping up the spider's blood without a second thought. This is a very undignified way to go out.
In a bug battle, there's no such thing as an invincible superhero. Make one slip, and you're dead meat. Some bug fights are one-sided. But in others, it's might versus might. As two evenly matched prize fighters slug it out, there can be only one. When a green praying mantis encounters a ferocious predatory katydid, the judge's verdict is final. The green praying mantis is a heavyweight fighter who's perfected the art of taking its opponents by surprise.
The mantis is like the biological equivalent of a stealth fighter plane. The color of the body, the flat triangular shape, everything about it has evolved to make this animal extremely difficult to spot.
When those huge compound eyes, with their 300-degree field of vision, lock onto a target, the mantis will attack. Even foes like this dangerous lynx spider.
The green praying mantis is quite confident to take on creatures other bugs will do anything to avoid.
The lynx spider spits lethal toxins made by venom glands in its head.
Both these animals are well aware of each other's presence, and they're both very, very fast.
The lynx spider makes a break. But it's caught and impaled on razor-sharp spikes. As a fighter, the mantis relies not on venom, but savagely sharp body parts. Inside each one of its front two raptorial legs is a vertical row of lethal curved spines.
These legs are like a cross between a mace and a grappling hook. They grab, snag, pierce, and pin the prey down all at the same time.
Barely pausing, the mantis eats through the lynx spider's legs, then its body, then its venomous head.
Eating the lynx spider venom glands won't have any ill effect on the mantis. If the venom was injected, that would be different, but for the glands to pass through the digestive system, no problems at all.
As a prize fighter, the green praying mantis appears invincible. Though in nature, that's never a given. There's another prize-fighting heavyweight in this forest. The ferocious predatory katydid. And it's evenly matched with the mantis in almost every way.
It looks like a leaf. It looks like this innocent leaf-like structure, but it is an incredibly dangerous predator.
Just as the green mantis blends in with the grass, the katydid, with its veined wings, hides among leaves. And like the mantis, The katydid comes equipped with sharp grappling spikes, not just on two legs, but on the front four. And up at the head, everything, including the mouth parts, are supersized.
These katydids have massive heads to provide plenty of space for these large mandibles and the muscles that control the mandibles.
Those mandibles are like Swiss Army knives. They lever and cut and fork in victims' body parts. The back legs are just as powerful. When they kick in, launch time becomes lunchtime.
It locks it up in its very strong, spiny arms, and then its mandibles just tear into it.
In a pre-fight weigh-in, the katydid is just as big as the mantis, just as strong, and is equally fast. Two heavyweights, evenly matched. And when they throw down, it will be a championship fight to the death. Next, facing off in the rainforest. Then, razor spines versus silken steel. And later, a stealthy killer stalks its victim. In a grassy arena, the two prize fighters enter the ring. Round one. In the green corner, the katydid sizes up its opponent with its long-range feelers. In the other green corner, the mantis has its guard up, ready to strike. The mantis throws a lightning-fast right jab. The katydid ducks for cover.
You have to give the mantis points for bravery. He's just so fearless, but I think he may have bitten off more than he can chew here.
Round two. The mantis comes out swinging. The katydid finds its range with its antennae. The katydid locks the mantis in a raptorial cage and delivers a killer bite to the mantis's eye. It's a cut no corner can repair.
Already, it's damaged the head, it's damaged the antenna, it's damaged multiple parts of the body.
There will be no round three. In an even matchup, sheer ferocity tips the scales.
Just goes to show that no matter how capable a fighter any particular animal may be, there's always something else out there that can tip the world upside down.
Step into the ring with a ferocious predatory katydid, and there's no such thing as a knockout. The loser never gets up. Some bug wars are won with brute strength. Others are subtle affairs, where skill and cunning make a killer all the more lethal. When a spiny tree cricket and a golden orb weaver share the same forest, sometimes the sharing stops and hostilities start. Bristling with razor-sharp spikes, plated with impenetrable armor, the spiny tree cricket has all the appearance of a bare-knuckle brawler. Looks can deceive.
These huge spikes all over its body, it looks like this fully armored battle machine. But guess what? The only thing it attacks are leaves, fruit, and bark.
But if ever it finds itself in a fight, the spiny tree cricket is a formidable opponent. The armored exoskeleton is seriously tough, and its spines are numerous and inflict nasty wounds.
In any fight, the spiny tree cricket has just one intention, and that's to get away. It doesn't kill on purpose, but it can kill with those big back legs.
The spikes serve another purpose. They make the spiny tree cricket hard to spot in the foliage.
The spiny tree cricket is a master of deception. All this bumpy, spiky armor gives the cricket a very irregular appearance, so even if a predator is climbing up the tree right towards it, it may not even notice the cricket.
One rainforest creature is a master concealer. Another is quite the opposite. With its gilded head and garish bright stripes to warn off predators, the golden orb weaver is no shrinking violet. And its web is as striking and as deadly as any.
The golden orb weavers didn't get their name for nothing. Their webs truly have this beautiful gold sheen, especially in the light.
A cocktail of chemical compounds inside the orb weaver creates a silk that reflects gold in the sun's visible light spectrum. The color has a dual purpose. It blends in with the forest and attracts aerial prey for the insatiable orb weaver.
Golden orb weavers are primarily eating butterflies, katydids. The silk is so strong and the spiders are so big that they're able to successfully capture small birds.
There are other creatures in the orb weaver's web, not victims, but distant relatives. Other spiders, kleptoparasites, that live off the orb weaver's leftovers.
In the city that is a golden orb weaver's web, the kleptoparasites serve as small-scale garbage collectors, essentially. They're cleaning up the web.
The golden silk is 6 times stronger than steel and 10 times more effective than Kevlar at dissipating energy. That means when something flies into this silk, the web stays in one piece and the victim stays trapped. But never underestimate a spiny tree cricket. Its spiky legs can rip an orb weaver's soft body parts to shreds.
The spiny tree cricket may be able to deliver devastating kicks with its back legs, but if they're tangled up in something as strong and sticky as a golden orb weaver's web, this could render it completely helpless.
Next, a fight to the death in a golden web. And later, Battle of the Blossom Feeders. High in the forest, a golden web weaver is about to do battle with a master concealer who could deliver a death blow with one superpowered kick.
It might not hunt other animals, but this cricket's no puny weakling. First off, it can grow up to 3 inches in length, and its back legs are long and really powerful. So it's not going to just lay down in front of a predator and say, "Eat me."
From its forest vantage point, the spiny tree cricket flourishes its super long antennae, searching for a tasty snack. It launches itself, but into an orb weaver's web. The sticky net absorbs the cricket's energy. At the same time, it glues her feet to the silk. The orb weaver rushes down. It begins spinning a silken shroud. Multiple threads stream from her spinnerets.
Depending on how strong the prey is, she'll start to wrap it up. She's essentially mummifying the prey.
The spiny cricket lashes out with its legs. Until those legs are bound, the orb weaver is in mortal danger. A well-placed kick or a razor-sharp spine slashing her soft abdomen could be fatal.
Golden orb weaver, it's a solid boot from one of those spiny back legs. This could easily penetrate the exoskeleton and do some serious damage. If it hits in an unprotected area, this could be fatal.
The cricket is still alive and kicking, but to no avail. The spider sinks in her fangs. Strong venom, golden bonds. There's no escape and no future. The tree cricket is done for. The golden orb weaver begins her meal. But tonight, the queen of this golden kingdom doesn't eat alone. One of her minions moves in to help. The spiny tree cricket is, after all, a very large meal. And when you're so good at killing, you can afford to be generous with your neighbors.
So there you go. Tough legs and a tough look don't stand a chance against the world's toughest spider silk.
In a bug war, some battles are like cage fights. It's muscle on muscle, no holds barred, and no referee to stop the fight. The desert scorpion and the desert centipede are a menace to many creatures, especially each other. If you want to survive in a hostile habitat, you'd better be made of tough stuff. And they don't come tougher than the desert scorpion and its superb fighting weaponry.
Two main things that scorpions have that are unique to scorpions. First, they have a stinger at the base of their tail that has quite a potent venom. In addition, their palps have been modified into pincers.
Those huge extended pincers grab their prey in a vice-like grip. But they're not the only claws. Modified mouthparts mash up the fresh meat and shovel it in. Not all opponents are quite so obliging. Tonight, the desert scorpion encounters an equally brutal fighter. the desert centipede.
If you're a bug, there's a few creatures you do not want to mess with. This is one of the most effective killers of the entire arthropod world.
One of the speediest on the bug world fight card. The desert centipede's 42 feet are fast and deadly.
Every one of the centipede's feet is tipped with a very sharp spike, and this allows them to traverse any kind of terrain, soil, rocks, tree trunks, or even grass. At top flight, only three or four legs are supporting the entire body, so they're like a venomous hovercraft.
At the front end are two vicious venom claws that inject toxins that ravage its victim's major organs. So like its scorpion opponent, the centipede, too, can finish off a fight with a lethal injection weapon.
But they can also use it to rip the prey apart, so they're sort of a biological Swiss Army knife.
Tonight, the desert scorpion faces a nightmare opponent.
Scorpions are really good predators, but they're not that mobile in the vast scheme of things. Compare this to the freight train of a centipede. These guys are really zippy. They're strong, and unless they're a whole lot smaller than that scorpion, I think the centipede has to win.
Next, a stinging, clawing fight to the finish. And later, a blood fest in the rainforest blossoms. On the rocky desert floor, two menacing night fighters are about to go head to head. Size, speed, and tactics will matter. And both have the fight skills to finish each other off. The desert centipede sizes up the scorpion with its antennae. The desert centipede tries a direct hit. But there's no avoiding those pincers. The centipede attacks again. The scorpion tries to run, but the centipede has it by the tail.
There aren't too many creatures that would be game to grab a scorpion by the tail, but the centipede is strong enough to pull this off.
The centipede bites the scorpion's tail.
What the centipede has done here is shut down the scorpion's main weapon. Now that the tail is completely immobilized, the stinger is useless.
With the stinger out of action, all the scorpion has are its claws. It snaps at the centipede.
Desert centipedes are pretty handy in wrapping up their prey. They'll use their entire body and all their legs to hold the prey perfectly in place while it delivers its venom.
The centipede climbs over its victim's back and sinks in its venom claws. It's a knockout and submission hold all in one. But in this cage fight, there's no tapping out.
The scorpion is never going to win this fight by trying to out-wrestle a 42-leg brute. Now that the centipede has its venom in, it's all over.
When these two night fighters step into the cage, there's no prize money. But you do get to eat your opponent. A bug's life is mostly a short one. just months, weeks, or days. And that's if they make it to old age. When a dreaded earwig and a bee-killer assassin bug go bump in the night, one life will not run its natural course. The earwig is like the garbage man of the bug world. Small and brown, it's like a cross between an ant and a cockroach. With the dexterity of a high-wire performer, it relentlessly scours the rainforest for a meal. Any meal.
Earwigs are omnivores, and what this means is that they'll eat essentially anything that they can encounter. They'll eat small insects if they get the chance, they'll eat garbage, they'll eat plant material, they'll eat fruit, they'll eat anything that they can get that's edible.
But what makes it really stand out from the grazing crowd are these. Forceps-like pincers, called cerci, that can inflict nasty wounds.
Those pincers are really used in defense. So if they're threatened, they rear their tail up and the cerci up. It looks like a scorpion's tail.
The pincers have even earned the earwig a fearsome reputation among humans.
Part of the reason why everyone knows earwigs is because of the myth that earwigs with these nasty cerci must be dangerous, and that in fact they go into human ears and try to bore into a human brain. You gotta be kidding. There's no way that an earwig would want to go into a small space in a warm human ear.
But to other bugs, those pincers are formidable weapons. That's not all. Up front, the earwig comes with well-developed mandibles that can do serious damage.
Even though the earwig's mandibles are relatively small, they're still able to effectively crunch through another insect's exoskeleton.
Nearby is another rainforest feeder, less mythical but equally bizarre. The bee-killer assassin bug looks like a beetle crossed with a bird.
This is one of the biggest species of assassin bugs, and it's a mean-looking beast. This vulture-like head, big beady eyes, and this weapon sticking right out the middle of them.
The assassin bug's killing fields are rainforest flowers. To dispatch its prey, the assassin has a fearsome weapon. A long, needle-sharp rostrum that sucks up the liquefied flesh of its victim. The assassin bug completely and fatally lives up to its name.
Once they've spotted a prey, the assassin bugs will often just freeze into position, and then the prey just becomes oblivious to their presence, and they'll creep very, very slowly up to it. And then when they strike, it's like a statue coming to life.
That rostrum doesn't just stab. Like a hypodermic syringe, it delivers paralyzing saliva that disables its victim's muscles and nerves. The rostrum now becomes a straw as the assassin bug sits back and slurps up a cockroach milkshake in its floral cafe. But will the killing fields be quite so cozy when a seriously armed earwig comes by. Next, a stabbing assassin stalks its prey. In the floral reaches of the rainforest, where lives can be short and bizarre creatures ply their deadly trade, the fully armed earwig has ventured into assassin bug territory. Wary of that dangerous tail, the assassin bug chooses its attack position carefully. The earwig is preoccupied.
Its best chance is to notice the assassin bug and move on as fast as it can. However, it looks like the earwig isn't paying attention.
The assassin bug attacks, but misses. In the confusion, the earwig gets away. This time, the assassin bug makes no mistake. With one quick stab, the assassin bug's rostrum pierces the earwig's back. Venom floods in. The earwig's deadly pincers are useless.
Assassin bugs have a nasty venom that has essentially paralyzed the earwig.
The earwig can't do anything with its pincers right now. It is completely incapable of fighting back. It might as well be inside of a straitjacket.
The assassin bug has its piercing mouth parts in the earwig and is sucking up the innards of the earwig. It's done.
The earwig's insides are dissolved and drained. The garbage man becomes garbage on the forest floor for others to finish off. One more creature that never makes it to a ripe old age. In the world of monster bugs, you lower your guard at your peril. Killers come out of nowhere. Unseen traps ensnare at every turn. And you can be ambushed in your lunch hour. In a bug war, take your eye off the ball, and it's the last thing you do.